The 1970s. It's a decade of terrorism, political assassinations, plane hijackings, and the taking of hostages. The memory of the 1972 Munich massacre is still raw, a bungled rescue which left 11 captives and one policeman dead. And in April 1980, US Special Forces attempt to free 52 Americans held captive in Iran. It's a hostage crisis that goes disastrously wrong. That was 6 days ago. And now, in May 1980, another terrorist crisis threatens bloodshed. Here in London, it draws together an unlikely group of people who are forced to find within themselves resources they never knew they had. The London policeman confronted by the heavily armed gang. The TV sound man who becomes the story when he's taken hostage. The Arabic-speaking journalist, the only man who can communicate fluently with the gunman. The police negotiator who must try to end the emergency without violence. And the soldiers, uniquely trained for just this kind of crisis. Day one. Trevor Locke is a British policeman. It's his job to guard the embassy door. Over the last year, he's seen big changes among the Iranian staff. There's a new government in Iran. Fundamentalist Islamic revolutionaries have taken power under their leader, the radical cleric Ayatollah Khomeini. Some of the staff Trevor Locke deals with here at the embassy are passionate supporters of the Islamic Revolution. But there are other people from Iran here with a radically different agenda.
I just didn't believe what I was looking at.
Trevor Locke can only watch helplessly as the terrorists quickly round up everyone in the building, embassy staff and visitors.
They were shouting, you know, put your hands up, put your, stand against the wall.
I realized immediately what was going on. I speak Arabic and they were speaking Arabic. I heard, don't let him go, catch him up.
And within minutes, literally, I mean within minutes, they'd secured the building. It was that easy.
No one has ever attacked a foreign embassy in London like this before. The takeover brings on an equally audacious counter-operation by the police and security forces. Locke has just enough time to transmit a panic signal. He knows this will trigger a well-rehearsed police plan. Outside, nine of his colleagues sprint to Prince's Gate from posts at other nearby embassies. They quickly seal off and evacuate the immediate area. Mobile fast response units then cut off a wider area, known as the outer cordon. In less than an hour, the police ring-fence an area roughly 2 square kilometers around the embassy. Now the police must try to end the siege peacefully. That task falls to the anti-terrorist squad, Scotland Yard's elite detective unit. They can only guess at what's going on inside. Mustafa Karhouti writes for a Lebanese newspaper. He's in the embassy by chance.
After 1 hour, we tried to ask what the hell was going on. Of course, we had no answer, none of your business. And, or, you know, you shut up, don't talk to us. And we were certainly all wondering what was going on.
Sim Harris works for the BBC. This morning, he's waiting for a visa to go to Iran.
I didn't feel my life was in danger in those early parts of the siege. I always thought it was a bit more of a stunt than anything else.
Outside, the police implement the next stage of their plan to get the gunmen talking. They call in the negotiators. The plan is build a relationship of trust, then gradually persuade the gunmen to release the hostages and turn themselves in. Their first decision is a difficult one. To make contact with the gunmen, a negotiator and translator must go right to the embassy door without police protection. Detective Inspector Max Vernon is one of the six strong team. It's one of his colleagues out there in the firing line.
There are three options. One, you get shot. Two, you get taken hostage. Or three, they let you go.
Already the world's media are gathering. Every police move is under their scrutiny. The gamble pays off. The negotiator makes initial contact, unharmed. The gunman's leader is called Salim, and at 2:35 p.m., he issues his demands. He and his men are Arabic-speaking dissidents from the Iran-controlled region of Khuzestan. They're violently opposed to the Ayatollah Khomeini's regime. They've seized the Iranian embassy in London to draw attention to their cause, independence for Khuzestan. But they want more than just publicity. They're demanding the release of 91 political prisoners held by the revolutionary government in Iran. They seem prepared to talk, and the negotiators are in no hurry.
As long as you keep them talking, it doesn't really matter whether it takes a week, a fortnight, 3 weeks. A bit inconvenient for the neighbours, but as long as nobody's hurt, we don't give a damn.
But there's a sting in the tail to Salim's statement. He sets a deadline of 12 noon the following day. Meet his demands, or he will start to execute the hostages. Vernon knows that the negotiators have little room for maneuver. The revolutionary government in Tehran is notoriously unpredictable. There's no knowing how they'll respond to the gunmen's demands. For the British government, Home Secretary William Whitelaw has responsibility. He'll make any big decisions. He reports to the Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher. And he's alerted a force very different from the police. 200 kilometres away at their base in Hereford, members of a secretive British Army unit are getting ready. Highly trained and on permanent standby 24 hours a day, the SAS are on the brink of a rescue operation, the likes of which the world has never seen. Prince's Gate, London. Day one, the Iranian embassy siege. The minutes are counting down towards the deadline. Dozens of camera crews and reporters gather, eager to record how the police will handle the crisis against the backdrop of turbulent Middle East politics. The police negotiators have a straightforward plan. First, make the hostage takers dependent upon the negotiating team.
The objective is to isolate them. So if you cut off outside communication and you've got the place surrounded, you've got pressure on them.
In the days before mobile phones, that's easy. The police cut the embassy's telephone lines.
Negotiator 2, you can start moving down now. Will the officer with the set with Negotiator 2 acknowledge, please? Negotiator 1.
A policeman, seen here taking cover behind the embassy pillars, passes an army-style field telephone to Salim, the leader.
Just to see if there are any queries arising.
The negotiators can now begin the delicate task of creating a relationship of trust between themselves and the gunmen.
How's things? You okay?
Thank you very much.
Good. There's less than 24 hours to go until the deadline expires. Salim has threatened that he'll then begin killing hostages. The stress on the negotiators is enormous.
The main pressure is the fact that if you make a mistake, somebody dies. I mean, I've never, ever come across a situation in my life, before or since, when people's lives depended on what I said.
The team take turns. Three working the day shift, three at night.
Salim, I'll stay on the telephone if I may, just to see if there are any queries arise at the time.
It's psychologically demanding.
I could not talk to Salim on two consecutive times. It was impossible. When I'd finished to chat with him, which often took 20 minutes, half an hour, I was drained.
And the negotiators are still at a disadvantage. They don't even know how many gunmen Salim has with him, or what they're doing to the hostages. It's no accident that the team gave the terrorists a seemingly makeshift field telephone. It's part of the plan.
There is no electronic device in the phone. it just doesn't switch off. Information comes in, because once it's put down, people talk. And if they're within range of it, there is nothing they can do to stop it.
They can now monitor and record conversations inside the embassy 24 hours a day. Other officers set to work, gathering every scrap of data they can, especially about the terrorists and their weapons.
A lot of it is observation. You need to know exactly where everybody is and whether they are hostages or the bad guys. So there were people watching all the windows all the time.
They also use an array of optical surveillance tools, high-powered binoculars, long-range spotting scopes, and telephoto lenses. The anti-terrorist branch backs up the human observers with an electronic cordon, using an armory of high-tech equipment, including closed-circuit TV cameras, CCTV, state-of-the-art in 1980. They position the cameras to cover every view of the embassy. Day and night, these feed pictures to monitors in the police command center in the block of modern flats at right angles to Prince's Gate Terrace. The police have now worked out that there are 6 terrorists, but they still know very little about the state of the hostages. They need a new tool.
You use intrusive techniques to try and hear and see what they might be doing inside the building.
The police are in luck. The embassy at number 16 is part of a terrace of buildings, all now evacuated. They can access the embassy's 5 stories from the adjoining buildings, numbers 15 and 17, Prince's Gate. They plan to insert thin microphones through them to find out where the hostages are. To do this, they must drill holes in the wall.
Now, these buildings being 200 years old, the walls are some 2.5 to 3 feet thick of stone, and therefore drilling was a very slow and painful process, and, we feared, a noisy process.
On the other side of the wall, Salim is alarmed by the strange noises. Sim Harris, on edge after many hours at gunpoint, hears them too.
There was clearly a drill, a hand drill, going into the brick. Well, I knew what it was. I said, oh, I don't know what that is. I said, ask Trevor to come down and see what he thinks.
Harris and his fellow hostage, policeman Trevor Locke, have to think fast.
Oh, he said, I know what it is. It's mice. And they said, what are mice? What are these mice? Oh, little animals like rats. So they looked a bit suspiciously, and of course I joined in. Oh, of course you're right, Trevor, it's mice.
Salim seems to accept their explanation. By the end of day one, the police can celebrate some progress. They now know there are 6 gunmen, and Salim has released 1 Iranian woman. But inside the embassy, the remaining 25 hostages are still at gunpoint. It's only 12 hours till the deadline expires. Day 2. In just 5 minutes' time, Salim will begin executing hostages.
The clock was ticking. Everybody was worried about what will happen.
The deadline passes. The terrorists don't begin killing hostages. But the British government can't gamble on the situation remaining stable. They need a rescue plan. They need the SAS. In 1980, very few people have heard of the Special Air Service. It's unlike any other outfit in the British Army. An elite force. It attracts a certain kind of dedicated soldier.
To be part of the SAS, well, it was my dream. It was what I really lived for at that time.
SAS soldiers are highly trained in counter-terrorist tactics. Hostage rescue is their speciality. They arrive covertly in small teams. They set up their forward operating base just two doors away from the embassy at number 14, Prince's Gate. First, before anything else, the IA, the immediate action. It's a rough and ready plan that can be executed at a moment's notice.
The immediate action plan is, okay, if people start getting killed right now, we've got to go in, regardless of whether we've got any information or not. You've got your weapons, you've got everything ready to go, and you can mount an assault very, very quickly.
They decide on a brutally simple IA. Teams will burst out of number 14 and force their way into the embassy through the ground floor. It will mean going in blind, not knowing what they'll encounter.
You've got no idea what's inside. You might be going through the wall, through a door, through a window, through the roof, whatever, and you just deal with whatever you find inside. You know what I mean? You're talking really extreme.
Some of you might end up getting killed, but that's what you get paid for.
From this moment on, 24 hours a day, an IA team will be on standby. They're ready to go in at less than 2 minutes' notice. The trigger, if the police judge the terrorists are about to kill. The SAS now also begin to build a more sophisticated rescue plan. First, they need to know all about the terrorists. What weapons do they have? Will they be prepared to use them? The police work doggedly to profile the gunmen.
We backtracked to find out addresses, where they may have been, how they came into the country, how many they were, where they've come from.
People usually work in groups, and if you can find a couple of names, you can find their associates, and you can start to build a picture.
The SAS need to know exactly what the terrorists look like. They may have only seconds to decide whether someone is a hostage or a gunman.
Photographs are taken. A different man may come to the window at a different time. It gives us some idea of who is in there.
Hello, hello, hello.
Just beyond the police cordon, pro-Khomeini demonstrators intensify the pressure on the British authorities' resolve to end the siege quickly. Crucially, the police are now beginning to build a picture of the weapons the SAS could face. For 3 days now, police observers have made a careful record of every sighting of the gunman.
They're apt to be a bit paranoid, therefore they carry their gun. And this is where the observers, with their high-powered ocular devices, can say he's carrying a Browning, he's carrying a whatever.
Most of the terrorists' weapons are pistols, 9mm semi-automatics. But they also have two full-auto submachine guns, 7.65mm Scorpions. These East European weapons have a rate of fire of 850 rounds a minute. But the SAS are alarmed to discover that some of the gunmen are also carrying even more powerful weapons. Soviet RGD-5 anti-personnel hand grenades, each one packed with 110 grams of high explosive and 350 steel fragments. For 3 sleepless days and nights, Mustafa Kharkouti has seen these weapons at close quarters.
One character I never forget out of this gunman. He was looking for a fight all the time. And that was pretty dangerous. He would go into the room with a hand grenade in his hand, with his finger in the ring, and tossing it around like that, you know, in the middle of the room. And the mere fact that you see him doing this will generate a great deal of fear within every one of us.
Just yards away, the SAS must now fine-tune their rescue plan to take account of this new weapons information. They must be so quick and unexpected that the terrorists don't have the time to use their weapons. After 2 days of surveillance, they know a lot about the exterior, but not the interior.
Got to get this simple intelligence, yeah? Like the construction, door, the windows, even the roof, the walls. You've got to try and get your floor plan. Yeah, so, you know, you don't just go through one door and discover you're in the broom cupboard.
But from the architectural plans, they see immediately that there's a problem.
It was very hard to absorb a picture of the whole building because it was 5-6 floors and 50 rooms.
The embassy is a large and complex building. The SAS need to find a way to bring it to life so the troopers can visualize it. This grainy footage is genuine film of the SAS studying a 3D model of the embassy. It's a bird's eye view of the 6 floors of the embassy, laid side by side. The 130-year-old Georgian townhouse has 5 floors above ground and a basement level. A central stairwell runs down into the lobby, and there are balconies at the rear and front. At first sight, it looks a very tall order to carry out a quick and comprehensive attack on such a complex building. But the SAS have a unique approach, ideal for this operation. They work in small groups, usually 4 men. Each team gets to work, planning its own part of the rescue.
So we add areas of responsibility. This is your floor, this is your space that you're going to actually assault.
You actually had a choice, if you know what I mean, yeah? Basically, you think, right, we're going to go for that window, yeah? And you're getting it in your mind's eye, what is there?
Some teams slip away to take their preparations a stage further. At Regent's Park Barracks, they build mock-ups of some of the embassy rooms from wood and hessian. They practice moving through them, developing a spatial awareness of the layout of doorways and windows, of the places where terrorists may lie in wait. The standard weapon of the SAS anti-terrorist team is especially suited to this kind of situation. The 9mm Heckler & Koch MP5 is one of the world's most advanced and accurate submachine guns. The visa photographs, the eavesdropped conversations, the weapons data. Gradually, all these different scraps of information help the SAS soldiers fill in the gaps. They know who and what they're up against. But 72 hours into the siege, and they still have no idea when or even if that call will ever come. Day 4. 6 gunmen have taken control of the Iranian embassy in London. They've released 3 hostages, but threatened to kill the 23 people who remain captive unless political prisoners in Iran are released. But the Iranian government refuses even to discuss Salim's demands. The hostages don't know it. But on every side of the embassy, the SAS are making final preparations to end the siege in their own way.
The whole purpose of an assault is to attack every entry point at exactly the same time, causing the greatest amount of shock and surprise.
Speed is the key.
Your primary objective is to get in there to rescue the hostages. The longer it takes you to reach the hostages, the more chance it is of them getting shot or whatever.
They decide that the fastest way to overwhelm the terrorists will be to enter the embassy simultaneously at 3 main points. On the ground floor, they opt for the rear entrance leading in from the embassy garden. Above, the balconies give access to large windows, second floor rear and first floor front. John McAleese's 4-man team has the task of entering through the front balcony. Windows lead into first floor offices. McAleese's team select the nearest as their entry point. But it's shuttered and reinforced on the inside and could take precious time to break through by hand. Every second wasted risks hostages' lives. They opt for explosive entry using a special device called a frame charge.
It's like a ring of explosives. So it will cut a hole through a wall, a window, a door, whatever.
In number 14, McAleese's team prepare the plastic explosive charge. They tape it to a frame made to fit the target window. They know this from the embassy plans.
We were actually using a polystyrene block or sheeting, and all this is just to maintain the shape.
The circle of explosives should blast away the entire window. At the rear, Robin Horsfall is one of a team given the ground floor garden entrance. To guarantee speed, they too opt to blow their way in.
we were to follow up on the explosive entry, which was supposed to blow the door to pieces, and then hold the back door.
Directly above Horsfall's position, another team gets the second floor rear balcony as their entry point. They'll abseil down 40 feet from the roof above.
We were as ready as we could be. We were a sharpened knife.
The SAS rescue plan is complete. Day 5. The hostages are becoming increasingly anxious. None of them gets much sleep, and they've had little to eat but biscuits and takeaway meals sent in by the police. The negotiations don't seem to be making progress, and tension is rising.
As the siege went on, the gunman, especially the leader, was really getting frustrated. He was getting agitated because the authority outside was not responding to any of his demand.
Mustafa Karkouti, captured on film here at the window with Trevor Locke, has been a linchpin of the negotiations. He's fluent in both English and Arabic, so he's become a mediator between the terrorists and the police, and helped the British hostages understand Salim's plans.
Mustafa, who for me was a top man, said things are very bad here, Mr. Trevor. They're talking of killing everybody. And he just couldn't take any more.
I had a lot of pressure during this siege. And I was sweating all the time. And also feeling my knees were not able to hold me anymore. It was a pretty bad situation.
Salim agrees to let Karkouti go.
They carried me down, and for the first time, I feel the air, the smell of the atmosphere you feel as if, you know, the life is coming back to you somehow.
Salim has now released 5 hostages. 21 men and women remain at gunpoint. Without Karkouti to translate, the British hostages feel increasingly isolated and desperate.
It was absolutely dead silent, you know. No one was talking to anybody. If you said anything, you whispered it. But most of the time, you just didn't want to say anything to raise attention to you.
Day 6.
Things started to go dreadfully wrong on the 6th day. They were all very down. There was a very bad atmosphere there.
Whether they thought they'd be out in a few days, I don't know. But they were getting frustrated. And I think there was a bit of a dissension in the ranks. We heard heated arguments between the terrorists.
Tension between the terrorists and the more committed revolutionary Iranian hostages has been building. Now Faisal, Salim's second in command, singles out one of the embassy staff. 29-year-old Abbas Lavasani is a fervent supporter of the Ayatollah Khomeini. He's already declared himself ready for martyrdom.
And Faisal walked in and he pointed at Lavasani and he said, "You want to die? Come on." God.
As Lavasani is led away, Harris and Locke make a desperate call to the police negotiating team.
And they said, "You know, what's happening?" I said, "They're going to shoot this guy. They seem serious." And they said, "Oh, is there nothing? You please, please try and stop them." I said, "I mean, I can't do anything." The tension was terrible.
I then heard bang, bang, bang. That was a shot immediately followed by a groan, followed by 2 more shots. Although I hadn't seen it, I'd heard a classic execution.
I really started thinking about my life insurance, yeah.
Outside, the police hear gunshots. But they can't tell what's going on in the embassy. For 5 tense hours, the negotiators wait to discover if the terrorists have indeed killed a hostage, if their strategy has failed. Then, at 6:50 p.m., a body is pushed out of the embassy front door. Armed police give cover as 2 men dash forward with a stretcher. After 5 days of negotiations, the terrorists have at last carried out their threat to murder. Inside number 14, the SAS teams make last-minute checks. They're on standby to go. Faced with Salim's threat to kill another hostage in 30 minutes' time, Home Secretary William Whitelaw gives the order. At 7 minutes past seven, the police commander, Deputy Assistant Commissioner John Dello, signs over control to the military. Max Vernon has done his utmost to arrive at a negotiated settlement. The fate of the hostages is now out of his hands. It's a bitter moment.
I thought we'd failed. We'd failed to do the job to get the hostages out unharmed and the terrorists into custody, which in fact is true. And that it was left to the SAS with their expertise to finish off something that we had failed to do.
As the SAS begin to move into position, there's one last job for the negotiators to do. For the final time, Max Vernon picks up the phone.
Our objective was to keep that telephone occupied.
He has to distract Salim for as long as possible while the SAS close in. The ruse he decides on is to discuss complicated arrangements for getting the gunmen and hostages to the airport to make their getaway. Sim Harris also talks to Vernon on the field telephone.
And they said something to me like, is Trevor with you? Is the leader with you? And I said, yes, we're together. So they said, we want you to tell them that we will take you to Heathrow in a coach and Trevor will drive the coach. Okay. And I thought, well, this is incredible detail. This must be happening.
I couldn't believe it, and I thought to myself, the bastards have given in. I said, they want to talk to you about the coach and the aircraft, so he took the phone from me.
Salim gets back on the phone.
If we have one coach, is that going to be enough? Because Mr. Trevor will only be able to drive one coach, won't he?
Yeah, it's one enough, about 25 feet. 29 feet, sorry.
Outside, Horsfall McAleese and the rest of the SAS teams move stealthily into position, waiting for the signal to attack. The press catch their first glimpses of the SAS. Black-clad figures get ready on the embassy rooftop. They quickly thread onto the prepared abseil ropes, ready to go. Vernon tries desperately to keep Salim's attention, while out of the corner of his eye, he can see the SAS.
We knew that the SAS were coming. We, in fact, could see them, because we had our own monitors, which were private, totally isolated from anything else, so that we could see what was going on.
The eight men on the roof let go their ropes and begin the descent. Watching them, Vernon keeps talking. It's a dreamlike moment.
I remember distinctly having this little child voice in my head, singing, I know you're going to die. It was absolutely weird and I couldn't stop it.
Then Salim hears something.
Salim, we are listening to some suspicion movement.
There is no suspicious movement.
There's suspicion. Okay.
Salim.
Just a minute, I'll come back again. I'm going to check.
Salim, there is no suspicious movement, Sim.
The abseilers are down. At the front, figures emerge onto the balcony, then duck back into cover. It's 7:23 p.m. Millions watch as the embassy is swathed in smoke. Cameras see only a fragment of what's going on. Gunfire, explosions, and screams echo across Prince's Gate. Beyond the smoke, the extraordinary rescue operation unfolds. It's the culmination of days of meticulous SAS planning. The first move on the front balcony. McAleese jumps across to place the ready-made plastic explosive frame charge. His teammate holds the live detonator.
I say to Tom, because Tom is holding it, I say, do not press that fucking trigger, you know, because I'm holding this thing.
McAleese could be killed if it goes off too soon.
Head in it, Tom, fire, kaboom. Then basically just turn around and then we're back in the window again.
Don't forget, the phone was open. I could hear everything that was going on within that embassy. and I have never heard so much noise, screaming, machine guns. I was a soldier and I fired guns, but this was an assault.
At the rear, there's a problem. One of the abseil team is in trouble. The rope has snagged in his rig. He's helpless. Every second wasted jeopardizes the lives of the hostages. The rest of his team must keep moving. Now stun grenades have set fire to the curtains.
So I stood underneath him and he was pushing himself outwards from the building. Everybody could hear him scream. I was looking up at him and thinking, well, there's nothing I can do.
The only troopers who can help are on the rooftop 40 feet above. But it isn't easy.
The guys on the roof had to try to cut him down on the inswing, because if they cut him down as he pushed himself out, he would have fallen another 40 feet onto solid concrete.
They take a chance and cut the rope. The man falls 10 feet and lands heavily. Despite third-degree burns, he carries on inside. Meanwhile, at the rear, it's taking too long to lay the explosives on the door. Horsfall's team could lose surprise.
My partner, Bob, and I ran forward, and Bob said, screw the explosives, I'm using the sledgehammer. So he just took the back door out with the sledgehammer, and we went over the explosives and into the back door.
On the first floor, Sim Harris is engulfed in smoke and noise as McAleese's team burst in.
I didn't know what was happening. And these guys are there in black suits and with hoods and gas masks. And I thought, bloody hell.
Harris is left on the balcony while McAleese and the others push inside.
Burning embers started dropping on me from the room above. All my jacket was beginning to burn. You know, I said, I'm going to burn to death here.
McAleese beckons Harris into safety from the adjoining balcony.
I did my balcony scene of hopping across and took me back into an office.
All the SAS teams are now inside. They move through the embassy, clearing the maze of rooms. They move fast. If they encounter a terrorist, there's no time for careful aiming. Instead, they rely on a technique learned through hours of intense practice.
It was called instinctive shooting. All you would do is push it forward and just look at the target and shoot, and you knew you would hit the target. We were trained that intensively.
McAleese's team run into Salim, but Trevor Locke is beside him.
And then I heard the door fly open. I heard Trevor. His voice spoke my name as if he'd known me all my life. And Trevor, get away. And it wasn't one of these situations you think, shall I, shan't I? You instantly respond to his command.
The SAS have memorized the faces of the hostages as well as the terrorists. And Locke is easily ID'd.
Over, I heard. Yeah, the trail of bullet holes diagonally across his top half of his body.
Salim is dead.
Then I was in a bit of a state. I couldn't breathe. My skin was screaming. And I leant out the window and took the biggest lungful of fresh air that I could get hold of.
McAleese's team had cleared the first floor. One floor above, the abseil team fight their way to the most important room in the embassy, where most of the hostages are held. In the chaos, the terrorists open fire on their captains. They kill one and injure two more before the SAS shoot the gunman dead. Four of the six terrorists have been killed. The SAS have found the remaining 19 hostages. Now they must get them outside. There are still two well-armed terrorists on the loose. To the SAS, the Iranian embassy is still live. Day six. The SAS rescue mission to bring an end to the Iranian embassy siege is now in its final stage. They've located the hostages, but the building is far from secure because there are still two terrorists unaccounted for. Before the fire gets worse, the SAS need to evacuate the hostages, and fast. They have a well-rehearsed procedure for just this kind of chaotic situation. The troopers form a human chain from the second floor down the stairwell. It's the fastest way.
Look away!
Yeah, they just got hold of you. They're screaming at you, and they just got hold of you and just threw you down and outside.
We just threw them. I mean, it was like throwing basketballs. We'd bang, 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 off they'd go.
Then, in the confusion, in among the chain of hostages, one face triggers alarm bells for John McAleese.
It was like total recognition at once, you know?
One of the two remaining gunmen. He barges through and races down the stairs. He's carrying a grenade. If he pulls the pin, there's nowhere to hide. The blast will kill and maim. But the SAS daren't shoot.
None of us could open fire because the bullets would have gone through the terrorists and possibly hit one of our own troops behind.
Instead, a trooper lashes out with the butt of his weapon. It doesn't stop him, but it's enough to push him down into the open, to Robin Horsfall. No hesitation. There's a live grenade.
And the man ended up just collapsed. He was dead.
You can't take a chance of him anything else, so, I mean, it's... You've got to stop him, you know?
Seconds later, the last hostages are out of the burning building. The SAS now collect them together in the embassy garden and lay them face down on the grass, hands bound with plastic cuffs.
People might say it's cruel because they've been in there held captive, but you've got to determine who the good guys are and who the bad guys are.
No one can relax. There's still one terrorist unaccounted for. The SAS now verify each person's identity.
One of them came to me and he had a big chart with photographs on. And he said, "Ah," I said, "we know who you are, you're Sim Harris. We'll tick you off."
Relief gives way to alarm when Harris notices the man next to him.
Sim Harris was shouting and nodding his head towards a man who was also laid on the floor amongst them, saying, "He's a terrorist, he's a terrorist."
And he pointed then at the terrorist. He said, "Is he a terrorist?" And I said, "Yes, he's a terrorist." When they were positive he was, they lifted him and took him away.
Fawzi Badvinejad is the last of the six terrorists, the only one left alive. He's later sentenced to life in prison. Five hostages were released during the siege. As well as the murdered Lavasani, one hostage has been killed and two wounded by the terrorists during the SAS assault. 17 are released unharmed by the SAS. They're evacuated straight away for hospital checks. Sim Harris emerges here, waving to press colleagues.
I saw a camera crew on you, you see. I was really pleased to get out. I was waving at them, fairly elated by this point. And they'd got this sort of reception there, and women standing there with clipboards. And one of them came up to me and she said, "Do you speak English?" I said, "Yes, of course I do." "Oh, yes, okay." I always remember that.
At 8:15 p.m., the police declare the siege officially ended. The operation is considered a stunning success. The news cameras have broadcast every moment live. The Special Air Service are now headline news.
Willie Whitelaw, who was the Home Secretary at the time, came in, brought the Prime Minister's congratulations, and he was in tears. He had tears running down his face, and he was saying, "I knew you'd do a good job, but I never knew it would be this good."
But the newfound celebrity is not the SAS's style.
And he wanted to take us out and parade us to the world's media. And the commanding officer, of course, said, "No, that's not what we do. We've actually got to remain anonymous and get out of here."
Then, of course, you've got the sort of 2.5 hour, 3 hour drive back to Hereford, you know? Yeah. Because remember, I mean, we were working the next day. Yeah. You don't get a day off.
Controversy emerged in the aftermath when it was alleged that two of the terrorists were shot while unarmed and trying to surrender. But at the coroner's inquiry, a jury cleared all the SAS soldiers involved. The astonishing success at Prince's Gate led to the SAS being regarded as the foremost counter-terrorist force in the world.
We actually set a benchmark for the rest of the world in how terrorist operations should be handled and handled well. And that is still a benchmark that people look back to.
For their part in the storming of the Iranian embassy, five members of the SAS were decorated, including the man who continued on despite being severely burned. PC Trevor Locke was awarded the George Cross. Operation Nimrod, as it was codenamed, remains one of the most successful hostage rescue assaults the world has ever seen. The staff Trevor Locke deals with here at the embassy are passionate supporters of the Islamic Revolution. But there are other people from Iran here with a radically different agenda.
I just didn't believe what I was looking at.
Trevor Locke can only watch helplessly as the terrorists quickly round up everyone in the building, embassy staff and visitors.
They were shouting, you know, put your hands up, put your, stand against the wall.
I realized immediately what was going on. I speak Arabic and they were speaking Arabic. I heard, don't let him go, catch him up.
And within minutes, literally, I mean within minutes, they'd secured the building. It was that easy.
No one has ever attacked a foreign embassy in London like this before. The takeover brings on an equally audacious counter-operation by the police and security forces. The 1970s. It's a decade of terrorism, political assassinations, plane hijackings, and the taking of hostages. The memory of the 1972 Munich massacre is still raw, a bungled rescue which left 11 captives and one policeman dead. And in April 1980, US Special Forces attempt to free 52 Americans held captive in Iran. It's a hostage crisis that goes disastrously wrong. That was 6 days ago. And now, in May 1980, another terrorist crisis threatens bloodshed. Here in London, it draws together an unlikely group of people who are forced to find within themselves resources they never knew they had. Locke has just enough time to transmit a panic signal. He knows this will trigger a well-rehearsed police plan. Outside, nine of his colleagues sprint to Prince's Gate from posts at other nearby embassies. They quickly seal off and evacuate the immediate area. Mobile fast response units then cut off a wider area, known as the outer cordon. In less than an hour, the police ring-fence an area roughly 2 square kilometers around the embassy. Now the police must try to end the siege peacefully. That task falls to the anti-terrorist squad, Scotland Yard's elite detective unit. They can only guess at what's going on inside. Mustafa Karhouti writes for a Lebanese newspaper. He's in the embassy by chance.
After 1 hour, we tried to ask what the hell was going on. Of course, we had no answer, none of you.
The London policeman confronted by the heavily armed gang. The TV sound man who becomes the story when he's taken hostage. The Arabic-speaking journalist, the only man who can communicate fluently with the gunman. The police negotiator who must try to end the emergency without violence. And the soldiers, uniquely trained for just this kind of crisis. Day one. Trevor Locke is a British policeman. It's his job to guard the embassy door. Over the last year, he's seen big changes among the Iranian staff. There's a new government in Iran. Fundamentalist Islamic revolutionaries have taken power under their leader, the radical cleric Ayatollah Khomeini.
Some of the business, and or, you know, you shut up, don't talk to us. And we were certainly all wondering what was going on.
Sim Harris works for the BBC. This morning, he's waiting for a visa to go to Iran.
I didn't feel my life was in danger in those early parts of the siege. I always thought it was a bit more of a stunt than anything else.
Outside, the police implement the next stage of their plan to get the gunmen talking. They call in the negotiators. The plan is build a relationship of trust, then gradually persuade the gunmen to release the hostages and turn themselves in. Their first decision is a difficult one. To make contact with the gunmen, a negotiator and translator must go right to the embassy door without police protection. Detective Inspector Max Vernon is one of the six strong team. It's one of his colleagues.